I am my own worst enemy. Please don't let me kill my crazy self. Please don't let me do myself in, physically, emotionally, mentally, or any other way. Deliver me from my own evil tendencies. That's not a bad prayer, is it? Sure can't do any harm. I'd recommend that you pray that. God, deliver me from my own evil tendencies. But then what do you think happens? A magic wand just goes over your head and sis boom ba, you're delivered? Well, maybe for you, but that hasn't been my experience. My experience has been to ask God for His help and then to participate in my own life, to own my own mistakes, to face them head on, to admit them. Really, there's nothing wrong with that. To admit to people, I don't know, or I failed, or I blew it, or I stumbled, I screwed up. Maybe you need to find a confidant, someone you can truly trust to keep that to themselves, and just say, I need to talk. I heard someone in church many, many years ago who says, you know, the Bible says, confess your faults one to another. Well, he added, but confess your sins to God. You've got to be careful who you choose as your confidants, because you don't want it to snowball into something you never intended for it to be. And we are all human and capable of turning and doing the wrong thing, saying the wrong thing, and often forgetting that this was told in confidence and reiterating it to someone else. So be very careful. Use a confidant that you know has a relationship with you, as an attorney has to his client who he is sure has committed that crime. He has a client privilege, a client attorney privilege. He will not divulge that information. Find someone in your life who's like that. And if you can't, then simply turn to God, because He definitely will keep that to Himself. Sometimes people don't blame the devil. Guess who else they blame? You think they blame themselves? Well, sometimes. More often than not, though, they blame other people or situations. Maybe even a specific group of people. A church. An organization. The greater fact is this. It isn't what people say about you or to you that's going to matter in the long run. It's what you say about yourself to yourself. A spirit of infirmity is a bondage that another person places on your life. It's not a bondage of chains and shackles and prison bars on the outside of you. It's a bondage on the inside. And those are the hardest to break out of, you know. And you can't walk away from bondage that's on the inside. It'll keep you locked up until you quit agreeing with the person who has mistreated you. You know, I've seen people counsel. I've seen husband and wives counseled, you know, pastors and their wives. I've been part of that, who counsel people who have been abused, women who have been beaten by their husbands over and over and over again. The wife would get as far as the door and have an attack in which she could hardly breathe after the counseling. His presence and his blows, his hits, his attacks weren't the main reason she was in bondage, you see. It was the bondage primarily in the way that she felt about herself. She had allowed his blows to beat her down so much that she lost her self-esteem until there was virtually no self and no esteem left. Jesus asked his disciples, "Who do men say that I am?" They gave him all the latest gossip. Some say you're John. Some say Elijah. Some say Jeremiah. Some say one of the other prophets. Jesus said, "I'm not concerned about what others say or what some say. Who do you say that I am?" That's Matthew 16:13-15. "Some say won't hurt anybody. You say will. It can make all the difference in your life. So many people I know have made it their life's work to change somebody's opinion about them. They're determined to prove that they are worthy or valuable in that other person's eyes. Their goal in life is to show somebody that they're good, that they're a Christian, that they're important. Never allow another person's good opinion of you to be your goal. The fact is, they might never like you. You see, you can't control other people. You can only control yourself, and barely that sometimes. Am I right? Sure. If you agree with the person who rejects you or abuses you, then you put yourself into bondage. If you say, yeah, they were right to hit me, I'm worthy to be hit. Yeah, they were right to leave me, I'm worthy to be left. Yeah, they were right to hurt me, I'm worthy to be hurt. Then you're tying yourself up with their opinion rather than tying yourself into God's opinion of you. When their bad opinion of you becomes your bad opinion of you, there's a prison built inside your soul with only one prisoner in it, and that's you. Are you prepared to deal with the fact that the person you've spent your entire life trying to impress may never be impressed? Are you prepared to face the reality that from God's perspective, it doesn't matter one way or the other if he or she is impressed or not impressed? Are you? Are you prepared for that? You want someone to like you so much that you're sure, if I wear this, if I talk like this, if I attend this church, if I drive this car, surely they'll like me if I agree with every political view they have, every religious view they have, every view they have. Well, I'm sorry to tell you, it doesn't really happen that way. People don't always like you back. They just don't. And there you are, in that prison, with one prisoner. You, and you're in solitary confinement, my friend. You're there alone to face only you. Only you. Are you prepared to deal with the fact that the person you've spent your entire life trying to impress won't be impressed? Think about it. Prepare yourself for that. It will happen. If it hasn't already happened, it will happen in your lifetime. That is the way of mankind, the way of humankind. That's the way of interaction, interpersonal relationships. That's how it goes down. Sorry to tell you. Didn't mean to burst your bubble. I didn't mean to do that. But sometimes you need to hear just the truth, because according to the Word of God, the truth will set you free. Free from what? That self-imposed prison of one. You. Table for one, please. Yeah, it'll just be Sandy today. And I'll be eating bread and water because I don't deserve better. Yeah, and I'll be by myself because no one needs to be around me. Nobody likes me. I've tried. It's me. It's just got to be me. Yeah. Is that how you are? I've been there. I go back there occasionally and visit. I don't like that restaurant. I don't like that prison. And the bread and water? Well, it sucks. I want meat, potatoes. I want a bounty spread before me. Seems that I read that somewhere before. He prepares a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. He anoints my cup with oil until it runs over. Yeah. See, that's what God does for us. I encourage you to come to the conclusion that I reached a long time ago. You ready for this? It's very profound. People are crazy. They're crazy. And when I use that term, I mean, they're fickle. You can please them today, and they'll hate you tomorrow. They're fickle. That's not a great theological truth, but it's good practical common sense. You'll never be able to figure out why some people do what they do. You'll never be able to predict all the foibles and quirks and eccentricities of human nature. You'll find yourself shaking your head all the way through life saying, why did she do that? Why did he allow that? The only explanation is that people are crazy. That's why God called you to worship Himself, not people. You won't get anywhere by worshiping a person, which is what you're doing if you're seeking that person's approval as the most defining opinion about your life. You see, the wonderful thing about God is that He doesn't meet with the board or the committee before He decides to bless you. He doesn't have to get anybody else's approval before He pours out His love to you. He doesn't consult anybody about you. Don't get me wrong, I do like people. I just know what to expect and what not to expect from them. If you're not careful, the craziness of other people will drive you crazy. If you're going to deal effectively with people in this world, you've got to be able to work right alongside them, but not allow yourself to be controlled or governed by their opinion of you. The deliverance you likely need most is not a deliverance from the devil or a deliverance from another person. The deliverance you probably need most is a deliverance from something in your own heart and mind. Ask the Lord today to open the prison doors of your own soul, and to set you free. You see, He can do that. He can deliver you from evil, even though you might have been breaking inside, and I know that many of you are. Many of you are. I'm going to close out with a song by Chris Tomlin. It'll fade out because my time is running out. Go out there today and love someone. But remember this, God loves you just like you are. He really does. Here's Chris Tomlin. I Will Rise.
There's a peace I've come to know, though my heart and flesh may fail. There's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when He calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will on eagle's wings before my God, fall on my knees and rise. I will rise. There's a day that's drawing near, when this darkness breaks to light and the shadows disappear, and my faith shall be my eyes. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is one. He is a real